Well, I'll look here with the next session on category theory and functional programming. Let's do a little recap. In the introduction, we talked about expressions, and basically expressions are evaluated to a result. And such a result can then be used as a parameter for continuing evaluating this expression. Think of the first expression we talked about then as a sub-expression. Its result is then fed to a continuation that continues evaluating that expression. We have generalized those expressions to computations which more or less do the same, but then we are talking about execution of computations. So computations are executed in order to yield a result. A result is of type CZ. Think about it as a box where with a Z in it, or a Z, whatever you want. And suppose we did that for a subcomputation and we had some box containing a result of type Z, then we could feed that as a kind of local value to a continuation where it's visible as a Z and where we can continue the execution of the computation to yield a result of type Y, so to speak, a box with a Y in it. This explanation also kind of explains that computations are not really black boxes. They are not boxes that are never opened. No, they are boxes that are opened because here there is a C in the box, but we open it to feed it to the continuation. So computations, they promote white box reuse. Let's contest this with functions. Functions are maybe a more high-level construct, and they are combined with combinators that only yield, only need functions as parameters and yield back functions. So they promote black box reuse. The typical example is the sequential competition. The sequential composition of functions that yields a new composed function. We've also generalized those functions to programs, and then we entered the world of category theory. And in fact, the computations which we saw in the previous session are also part of category theory. They correspond to monads. Now, I've also already stated that expressions are the workhorses. A function is defined in terms of expressions that are evaluated to yield a result when the function has been given an argument. In the same way, the computations are the workhorses in the category theory realm, because they also are executed to yield a result of type Y when the program has been given an argument of type C. Of course, the programs which we see here are very special programs. They are programs that are functions, and instead of functions to normal values, they are functions to continuations. Not all programs are functions like that. And in fact, before continuing with the main topic of this session, namely going reactive, I want to first say something a little bit more theoretical. What distinguishes the more general programs from programs that are defined in terms of computations? Well, since they are actually functions, you might be able to guess it. It will be the fact that they can be applied, because a function can indeed be applied to an argument. So let's introduce our next programming capability application with the corresponding file. And here's the code. So it's very much like applying functions, but in this case applying programs. I have a tuple consisting of a Z and a program from Z to Y, and given both, I can produce a Y and not as a function, but as a program. Okay. And it is this capability that computations give to the programs defined in terms of them. Let's just also extend application. And let's define the thing, and it's completely trivial for the simple reason that it is a function. It's maybe not the best thing to do. Let's see. One way or another, see this thing twice. That's better. Well, since it is a function, but a function to a computation, and what we want is also a function to a computation, we can simply do the application. I think I forgot one closing curly brace, yes. Okay. And it's this capability, this programming capability to apply to arguments that distinguishes the more general more general programs from the ones that correspond to monads. Remember that the monads had more power of expression, but they are certainly less elegant than the programs. So we give up this power of expression, but we do give this power of expression to the library developers. The library developers have the full power of expression of computations, but we offer the application developer the more elegant, albeit a little bit less powerful programming model of programs. Let's see if this thing compiles here. Yes. Okay, so that being said, let's switch to some more concrete things, namely how to go from active to reactive. From now on, all programs will actually be functions to computations. And what we are going to do, we are going to define more and more powerful or feature-rich or whatever you want computations and corresponding programs by transforming computations. So the first thing we are going to do is transform computations, but there is a more general notion which is called a natural transformation. All transformations we are going to meet are natural transformations, so let's make a new folder. Natural transformation with the file natural transformation. In it. And I see an error, sorry for that. Let's search here as well. Natural transformation, then it should be somewhere. Okay, here it is. What's a natural transformation? Well, a natural transformation, instead of transforming values, it transforms computation. It transforms a from computation to a to computation. And indeed, it also, just like functions, has an apply a method, but in this case, the z doesn't change. It's actually a type parameter, but the constructor f is replaced by a constructor t, right? So it's more at the type constructor level than at the type level that the transformation happens. Very general concept, and we are going to give it this funny little arrow name. And as you would expect, just like with functions, you can compose natural transformations since they are just generic functions, it's the same, and then implementation as for functions. Okay, so next we are going to define what computation transformations are. Actually, all transformations will be defined in terms of natural transformations. As follows. So, a computation transformation, in this case, it's going to transform a computation, not an arbitrary from type constructor, but it should be a computation to a t, from a from to a t, and this t will itself be a computation, and as a consequence also will define a program. Now, in fact, we are cheating a little bit because it's still a trait. The only thing we can define is result. And how do we define result? We define it in terms of this natural transformation from to to. So you see, a computation transformation has a natural transformation from to to. And we are going to give its apply method a funny name, fc to tz, because that's actually what it does. It goes from fc to tz, right? We also know that f is a computation, and we're going to give its results a funny name, z to fc, right? Because the result of a computation wraps a z into a computation that results in z. Once we have z to fz and fc to tz, I think you already see that they can simply be composed. And what we get is a z to tz, right? And so that's our result. So we can always generically define result. We can still override it if we want. But binding is another thing. So computation transformations automatically have a result defined. Okay, so next, let's go reactive and let's define in implementation, because it's actually an implementation We have already active implementation, transformation. Sorry, we have already transformation here, yes. So new folder reactive. And let's call it reactive transformation. Recall that all transformations are computation transformations. Here it is, a lot of code. Okay, so what is the most important thing to look at here? That's this. So we are going to transform our computation C to a computation that, given a Z, gives us this type. If you forget about the C for a moment, you will see that Z to unit is a callback, and a callback to unit is a callback handler. So instead of a callback handler at the value level, you will have transformed your computation to a callback handler at the computation level. Let's call it a computation callback handler. Okay. So what do we need to define? We need to define the natural transformation from active to reactive, and we need to define the binding. What we will always do, just for helping us to understand the types, is have type aliases. So the C is the from, and then the computation callback handler of the from is the to. Also, this here, for your computation, we are going to call the results just like before, Z to FC. We're going to call the binding F. There are lots of units involved, and so it makes sense to also have this U to FU. You will see that it later on. So it's the unit instantiated Z to FC. So what's our natural transformation? We are going to do the exercise for this one, and also for binding. There is basically only one way to get the types right, and then probably the definition is correct. So I have an FC, which is here, and what do I need? A TZ. Okay, what is a TZ? A TZ acts upon an FC to U. So if I have an FC to U, that's this one here, what can I do with an FC to U? Well, I have my FC, so I will apply the FC to U, to FC, in order to yield a U, or value unit, and that's exactly what I want. So this is completely trivial. The result is there already, so the callback handler just handles the results. Binding, well, that's a little bit different, but it's also feasible. I have a TZ, and I have a Z to TY, and I need a TY. What is a TY? Well, here it is, a TY is a CY to unit, but CY was FY, so I start with an FY to unit. Here it is. Okay, so this FY to unit, I should be able to turn it into unit. So let's see what this thing here is. I think I can do that. Well, I think yes. While u is this thing, and let's call it u. Let's see what's happening. Okay, makes sense. And u is unit. Nice. So, okay, how did we find this unit? Well, we do have a way to result in a unit, but we can only do it with the z's, not with the y's. So let's start with tz. What is tz? Well, tz can act upon CZ2 unit, or since CZ is FC, it can act upon an FC2 unit. So it can act upon an FC2 unit. So you will still have to look at this thing. Okay, what can we do with FC? Well, we can bind it using our binding operator and we get a Z. Ah, but now we have a Z. So we can apply it. We can apply this function to it or bind it to this function in order to yield a ty. So we are now working with y's instead of z's. So this is a ty, you see, but the ty is actually an fy to u, okay? So, hey, I have a fy to u. So I can apply that thing to my fy to u in order to get a unit. And what can I do with the unit? I can apply the u to fu to the unit. It's a little bit of magic, but it just works. There's only one way to get the types right. Let's compile it. Voila. Cool. So we have our active implementation of computation, and as a consequence, so you have our reactive transformation. From this reactive transformation, we are going to define our reactive implementation by transforming active. But before doing that, remember that we also need materialization. So we have already the active materialization. Let's now go to the reactive one. And where do we find it? Here it is. And it's a little bit of the same mumbo jumbo. There is only one way to get it right. We still materialize to unit, so no big thing. I just for the sake of using funny names, calling a u to u just the identity of unit. So now we are going to materialize unit or unit. R is the just a second. I first need just a second. I put it in the wrong place, or is it in the right place? No, it's. I'm first going to because it's not going to compile, I guess. See, so I first have to do the computation thing. So computation active, let's do the computation reactive first, new, and then come back to this. But that's a little bit simpler because we have already our transformation. Wait a moment, I have to plug in my computer. So that the battery doesn't fail. Let's first do this here. And we do it a little bit top down because we're going to do something else before. Let's take another file as well. I think this is the right one. Implementation computation reactive, yes. But it still is not going to compile. Now it's going to complain about even more things. But don't worry, I'm also going to work at the program level. And this is going to define what we need. And then we are going to go over the code. That's the one I need, yes. Interesting on its own. Can I just see if it compiles now? So that I have enough? Yes, it compiles. So we worked top down, but of course I'm going to explain bottom up. So what is my reactive type? Well, it's the reactive transformation from the active type. Okay, so and in this case, it's just a callback handler. I also, just like we defined our program A, I'm going to define also arrow R for functions that go to a reactive computation. And now, what is this thing all about? Well, it's a fact that givens, that they can't extend or classes or whatever. So I need this object as a kind of intermediate. This reactive transformed object, I need it as an intermediate for defining this here, for defining how my computation is reactive. That's also a new feature of the language, by exporting the result and the bind of that object. Okay, then the next thing I was trying to explain was how we could materialize them. And in fact, I don't materialize, excuse me, I'm going to do this away, I think it's this one, yes. I'm not going to do it in its most general form. I'm only going to do it for my reactive type in my reactive program, not for the transformation in general. Why? Because the idea is that you either are working actively or reactively, so you either start all your computation transformations from an active one or from a reactive one, and reactive doesn't enter in the middle of the story, it enters at the beginning. So it's enough to define this. Of course, reactive computations themselves can be transformed. Right, so what is a materialize? It's also a materializing to a function from unit to unit. So that's not different from active. I've introduced this funny name for the identity. Just put an A before the U, the identity of unit. Now, what is U2RU? U2RU, that is a function from unit to reactive of unit. So it is expected to act upon a unit. Well, actually an active unit, but anyway. And so when we let this thing work on a unit, what do we get? Well, actually we get a reactive unit here. And this reactive unit, what can we do with it? We can only let it work on an AU2U, which we have here. So that's what we do. We let it work on this AU2U, and that's it. And we've already shown that it compiled. It's really like a little bit of typing mumbo jumbo, but believe me, there is only one way to get it right. So what do we have? I think we have everything. So What's next? Let's hope we have everything, I think. So let's go to our factorial back again. We're still working with exactly the same factorial program description. So let's go to this here and introduce a new folder, reactive here. And let's also here introduce a new file, factorial. And the difference between this factorial will exactly be another import. It's here, I guess. So we're in the package implementation program reactive factorial, yes. So we work with the reactive type, we work with the reactive given, we work with the reactive materialization, and exactly the same materialized main factorial. So the only difference is another type and two other givens. Dependency injection by import. As for the rest, it's the same thing. So let's compile this, seems to work. Let's run it. And now let's run the reactive 1.3, type in an integer, exactly the same. Isn't that cool?